more than 500 years ago, 502 to be exact, this weekend, something significant took place. Can anyone tell me what that was?
95 theses, right, doctor.
95 theses were posted on the door of All Saints Church in Wittenberg. And who did that?
Dr. Martin Luther.
Martin Luther. Those of you who are Lutherans out there should be very proud that on this day everybody is a Lutheran. Because today is Reformation Sunday. And then I stand myself, I position myself within the Reformation movement, the Reformation branch of Christian theology. I stand firmly within the branch of Christianity that claims its beginnings in Martin Luther. Of course, he didn't begin this newfound faith, he discovered it as he read the Word of God. We all know the story. Up until Martin Luther, the Bible as we have it, everybody has a copy of the Bible. In fact, I believe that there are homes where there are more than maybe 10 different Bibles or 20 Bibles. We all have our own copy of the Bible. We give every second reader a Bible of their own. And when they get confirmed again, we give them another copy of the Bible. The Bible is such a free book available today, but not so a few hundred years ago. Certainly not when Martin Luther was a preacher and a teacher. A very select few people had access to the Word of God. And they interpreted it in the way that they wanted to suit their own interests. Until Martin Luther began to read the Bible and began to compare the truth that he saw it and the way in which the church was teaching it and the church was practicing it, and he said, this can't go on. This can't be allowed. And so he posts his 95 theses on the doorpost of the church, basically objecting to one fundamental thing, and that was the issue of indulgences. What is an indulgence? It was a device by which the church had come up with to raise money for the building projects of the church. For every type of sin, they had a certain amount that they had figured out that would absolve people of their sins, that would wash away the sins of the people. And you can imagine what that does. Can you just imagine if you were told that unless you paid a certain amount of money to the church for the sins that you committed, that you would not have any forgiveness of your sins, that you would never become right with God until you pay the price for your sin. I mean, where does it end? Who of us can say, you know, I am not going to sin anymore from tomorrow? Martin Luther said, no, salvation is not something that can be purchased. Heaven is not something that can be bought. Forgiveness of sins is not something that you can bargain with the church and get a priest to offer you that forgiveness. It is not the way of the Bible. He takes his stand based on Paul's letter to the Romans. If you would please turn with me to that letter, if you have your pew Bible or if you have your own Bible, turn with me to the letter of Paul written to the Romans. And as you know, the background to this letter, Paul had never visited Rome. This is not the church that he started like many other churches. This is the church, in fact, he was planning to go and visit. He had a desire to go and be with this church, a Gentile church, a church that was meeting in the home of a lay person, a family. Says, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for all of you, because your faith is being reported all over the world. That word faith is something that we need to underline. The faith of the congregation, the church at Rome, is what Paul is thanking God for. When people think about you, when people think about this fellowship, when people think about your family, do they give thanks to God for you and for your family, for the faith that you live every day, or do they not? Stop for a minute and think about that. Paul takes time to acknowledge that the one thing that stood out as a characteristic trait of the church in Rome is their faith. And he kind of develops this concept of faith as he continues to write. When he comes to verse 16, he is kind of raising the crescendo where he says, I am not ashamed of the gospel because it is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes. First for the Jew, then for the Gentile. For in the gospel, a righteousness from God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last, as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith. There is no room in our faith relationship with God to somehow obtain this by any other means other than the grace of God. You and I can never come to that point in life, that place in life, where we can say, I have the faith that I have because of my effort. Certainly not. In his letter to the Ephesians, again, Paul in the second chapter makes it very abundantly clear, verse 8 and 9. It is by grace that you are saved. It is by grace you are saved, and that manner of yourself. Even the faith that you and I have to believe in the gospel is given as a gift. There is no place for boasting. Grace is something so close to my own heart, because I know that without the grace of God touching my life, I wouldn't be here. It's not something that I say, this is wonderful, this is what I want for my life. God took hold of me even before I knew who God was. John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist movement, 200 years after Martin Luther, again began to proclaim and teach this idea about the grace of God that comes freely, this salvation that is given by God freely, where he talks about the prevenient grace of God that precedes us. The word that teaches us that even when we were dead in our sins, God sent Jesus Christ to die for us. Even when we were enemies of God, God sent Jesus to die on the cross for us. Not because we were good people, not because we had any merit in and of ourselves, it is surely by the grace of God. And Martin Luther wanted to make sure that people understood that they didn't have to bear the burden of their sin any longer. They didn't have to pay for their sins through money and cash gifts to the church, but they simply had to receive it as a gift. But there was one other issue attached to this, and if you paid attention to the letter of James that we were reading a little bit earlier, There is an aspect of this faith issue that, that James is picking up, where he says, brothers, what is the point of you saying that you have faith if you don't lift a finger when somebody is in trouble? When some brother or sister is in need and you say to them, be well, be fed, and be warm, and then you send them without any assistance, what good is that faith? Love is what we need to show. Compassion is inseparable from professing our faith in Jesus Christ. Somehow there has crept into this theological viewpoint that if you have faith, you're okay. You don't have to do anything more. And what James is saying is, if you say you have faith and you don't show compassion and love and care for your neighbor, what good is that? It's a dead faith. And that Siddhartha asks us that question, what are the commandments? The two commandments that, that Jesus gave. He said, first of all, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength, all your being. Love God first. But then, as if to impress upon his hearers that you cannot love God, you cannot really show that love for God until and unless you do it to your neighbor. Jesus says, and the second is like unto the first. Thou shalt love your neighbor as yourself. Now, you may be thinking about, okay, if I have good neighbors, you know, okay, I love them. But if it's a bad neighbor, what do I do? Do I still have to love? In fact, Jesus goes the second mile on that one when he says, you know, no, not just your neighbor, but you love your enemy too. And I think that is where some of us have problems. We are okay to show love and care for those who we think deserve it. If somebody is good to me, I will be good to them. If somebody treats me well, I will treat them well. But if somebody says something ill about me, that is the end of it. I'm no longer going to be a nice person to that individual. They have ceased to be recipients of my goodness. How many times have I heard as a pastor people coming to me and saying, Pastor, we cannot stand this person. Pastor, we just don't want to deal with this person. Somebody was just saying yesterday to me, there's this one person in this church I can't stand any longer, so I'm leaving this church. Where will you go? Where will you go and find a fellowship, a church, where you won't find one person, you know, who doesn't like you? Believe me, there are people who don't like you and there's no reason for it. That is what sin does. Sin separates. Sin creates barriers. Sin creates this dysfunction in our relationships. The only thing, the only antidote to that is the love that Jesus is talking about. The love that goes beyond the good in other people. The love that seeks even the worst offender to welcome him home. You remember that story that Jesus told about the son who took all his inheritance and went to a foreign country and wasted all his inheritance. Did the father say, you know, you blew it, son. You had a chance. Look at your brother, how responsible he is. Taking care of the house business and being obedient to the father, and you went away, a rebellious son. You had your chance. I'm
not going to be able to show you the same love that I had for you before you left the house. Does he say that? No. He doesn't even let the son make his confession, runs after him, embraces him, kisses him, places new clothes on him, has a party, has a celebration. That is what unconditional love means. And I know when I say this, it's very hard, and I confess that. It's not easy to love the unlovable. Not easy to express affection where it doesn't deserve. I know it's hard. And yet, we have no choice. Even as God in Christ has accepted us just the way you and I are, rebellious as we are, disobedient as we are, you and I need to be the same way, welcoming, embracing, loving, being compassionate to those that create all kinds of problems in our lives. So it's not a matter of, I have my faith, I don't have to deal with people, I don't have to show any care or compassion, but it is having both a deep-seated faith in God, a deep-seated love for God, and at the same time, a deep, deep love for the neighbor, for fellow human being. This is sometimes very, very difficult, and it creates a problem for us. A problem to resolve in terms of our relationships with each other. Jesus knew all about it. Remember the time when he talked about someone who came to the temple to offer an offering, and there remembered that somebody had something against that person, somebody had hurt that person, somebody had said something about that person remembered. Even as that person was making an offering, what does Jesus say? Leave your offering. Go and reconcile. Go and become a friend again. I'm wondering how many people there are out there that you and I may have offended, or maybe they have offended us. With how many people there is a brokenness that hasn't been mended? I know it exists because I see it every day. I see it especially when I gather with families that come together for a funeral. And I do a lot of funerals, and at that time when the family is together, I see there's one family member sitting over there, another family sitting over here in this corner, and I say, Who is this and who is that? And they say, we are brother and sister. You're both from the same family. You're here for your father's funeral, and you don't sit with each other, you don't talk to each other. I hate him. I don't want to see his face. What kind of a testimony does that bear on those who don't know Christ? What kind of a divided body are we presenting to the world that wants to see genuine love within the body of Christ? What did Jesus say again? It is not by saying Lord and Lord and Lord that people are impressed. It is not about how you may testify or how you may sing or how you may do your thing. It is not by that the world will be impressed that you are my disciples, but it is the way in which you show love to each other. This evening I have a question, I have a challenge for you. Is there even one person out there that you haven't talked to, that you haven't had any contact or relationship? something happened a year ago, 5 years ago, 10 years ago, maybe even 30 years ago, that has cut off your relationship with that person. Maybe tonight is that time when you will say, God, I first seek your forgiveness. As much as you have loved me, as unlovable as I am, as much as you have received me, even so, give me the grace to reach out to this person or this family. I make my confession and I seek your forgiveness. If you would do that, God will bring such tremendous peace into your life. It has happened to me. I stand before you as someone who has had that kind of a hurt feeling about people who have done things. And sometimes people do things without even thinking about they're hurting you. They just do it. And it hurts you so deeply inside you, you hold that in your heart. And it eats you from inside, like a cancer. We need to get that out. On this Reformation Sunday, if there's one thing that we need to learn from Martin Luther and from all that he has left us in the legacy, is to know this, that we are accepted by God, by grace and grace alone, and nothing else. And that you and I need to go out there and be channels of this grace that God has brought into our lives, so that others will see you and see that same love that God has, and will be convinced that the God that you proclaim, that the God that you believe in, is truly a God of love. A God of love. Paul says that so eloquently. I have the gift of tongues. I can speak in the tongues of angels. If I have the gift of faith to move mountains, if I have the gift of prophecy, and I can unravel every mystery that is out there, what good is that if I don't have love? If I don't have love. May the Lord bring this conviction into our lives that we need to be people of grace, forgiving us as Christ has forgiven us, accepting us as Christ has accepted us, living in peace with others as God has offered that same peace to us. People tell me, no, that's not possible. I say, you're right. It's not possible. If you try it on your own, it's not possible. Galatians 5, 22, all again tells us, it is not because of what you can do, but it's because what the Holy Spirit can do. I cannot love as I ought to love. It is the Spirit of God, the fruit of the Spirit, that the Holy Spirit will bear in your life and in my life, the 9 fruit of love and joy and goodness, meekness, gentleness, long-suffering. These are wonderful abilities with which we can praise God, but not because we can do it. I can't do it, you can't do it, but the Holy Spirit can. The question is, do we let the Holy Spirit into our lives to do what God is pleased with in our lives? As you think about this, and as you remember some of these words, as you go back, and when there is a blockage, if you will, or when there is an impasse with somebody, remember that God loves you regardless of whatever may be in your life. And it's the same acceptance and love God expects us to offer for others. This evening we are thankful to you, Almighty God, for once again reminding us that you have chosen us, that you have loved us, simply because that is what you have chosen to do. We thank you for the privilege that you offer to us to show the same love and acceptance of others. And yes, Lord, it is not easy sometimes. It is not easy to love someone who has hurt us deeply. Not easy to love someone who has bad intentions for us. But we leave them into your hands. We commend them to you, O God, and we pray that you would fill our hearts with that same love that you have for us, that we may forgive and offer forgiveness, that we may show the love of Christ in all the ways that we can possibly do, not because we are able, but because your Holy Spirit can do that.